Hello, in this video I'll be taking a D1 mini and a MOSFET and making a tablet or phone charger. The idea being that we can keep the batteries at a nice safe level and prevent overcharging or undercharging. So, let's begin. So as with all my projects, I'm using this Vero or strip board, and I've got a piece ready cut, but what I need is, with the lines horizontal, I need 11 pins down and a number of pins across the same size as a D1 mini. Here I'll be using both the version 2 and the version 3 of the D1 mini. The D3 has the USB port on the top of the board, whereas the V2 has it on the bottom. So to give us enough space for the rest of the components, the V3 I'm using the normal pins at the bottom. The V2 I've put the pins at the top. You'll also notice that I've taken the ordinary pins, stripped out some of this plastic, and added two rows there just to lift it up to give us enough space. You'll see why in a second. And I've done that for both of these boards. The MOSFET is the P16NF06L, and the L there means low voltage. So you can trigger these with the logic level from the D1 minis. So first of all, I've got this Vero board, and what I've done is I've marked in D2. So I just put the board in. So this is the V2. And where V2 is on the board, there, I've just marked it up. And the same with the version 3 and D2 there, mark that side. So the first thing we need to do, using a 1K resistor, I'm going to miss a hole there because that's where the D1 mini is going. And I'm going to put a resistor in between that one and the bottom hole. So we get that soldered. The next connection I want is from the 0-volt line. I say, again, I'm using the version 3. And the 0-volt line is the second pin up. So let's mark that. So second pin up there. Now I'm using another resistor leg here. I'm just using it for the wire itself. So I'm going to snip that off. So this wire needs to go from our 0-volt line that we marked and the third one up. So we just need a short jumper there. So I'm just going to bend this. And we'll place that on those two, just like that. So that connects between third one up, miss one, and the 0 volts there on the D1 mini. So let's solder that on. Now we can put in our MOSFET. Now on the V3, it needs to go on the right. Obviously on the V2, that will go on the left. So we put that in there, just make sure there's enough space, nothing's touching, and we'll get that soldered. So I'm going to start with the middle pin. Nice bubble solder, and we'll just check that. So we'll continue with the other pins. Don't need to cut that, that's fine as it is. So there we've got the, for the version 3, a 1K resistor going from D2 to the bottom pin. We've got a link wire going from 0 volts or ground to the top pin there. Now we can put on the D1 mini. So using the version 3, we'll just pop that on. Now with the version 3, there's a chip underneath there. So we just need to pop this out a little bit. It's at a slight angle, but it doesn't matter. And there should also be enough space there just to plug that in. It'd be a slight angle, but we only need to plug it in once when we're programming it. So that looks good. So we'll solder that on. So as before, we just do the corners first. Now I'm not going to solder these down this side because there's no point. We're not using any of those pins. And I'm only going to solder the pins we're using on this side. So D2. Is used and then the 0 volts, and we've already done the 5 volts when we did the corners. We don't need to solder everything, just the pins we're using really. Next job is I'm going to drill out all the tracks between the D1 mini pins on either side. So I'm going to put this to one side, tidy up, and we'll prepare the USB cable next. The USB cable I'm using has got a right angle plug. And the reason being, this plugs into a wireless charger. It sits there on my desk and the cable's nice and hidden. So the first thing I need to do is decide where I'm going to put the box. Now, obviously, I've printed out some 3D cases. I'm going to have this, near the end of my one. You can put it anywhere along this cable, obviously. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to leave myself a bit of space. I'm going to cut that and then start stripping the wires. I need a fair length. So ideally, talking about just under the length of the D1 mini, I need stripped off. It's a good guide. And then I don't need any of this insulation, so I pull that back. Unwrap this. and we'll cut all that excess off. Okay, so USB cables, normally you have a red and a black, which is your 5-volt line, and then you have two data lines. Most USBs follow the color code rule, but it's always best to check. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to strip off the red and black. Put that twist. And then with my meter set to 20 volts, let's just make sure the polarity on this is correct. So we'll take the black, wrap that round, and the reds, I can just hold that, and then plug it into a USB supply, switch on. And then we see a nice 5 volts there in the correct polarity. So that's good. We know that's okay. We can get rid of these two. Not going to use those. And while I'm here, I'm going to prepare the other side. So again, I want about a D1 mini's length stripped off. Now I designed some of these cases with lids. You'll find the file in Thingiverse to download. So I've run both the cables through the holes that are in the case. At the end of the cables, just to protect against some of that shielding, it's a little bit of tape around each one just to hold that. Then I've connected the two red wires from both sides of this cable together, and then left a blob of solder at the end and a little bit of heat shrink there just to hold it together. So on the underside of the board itself, I've added three blobs of solder. The first one there is the ground pin on the D1 mini. The next one along is the 5 volts. And then the last blob of solder I've added is the middle pin of that MOSFET there. We attach our USB wires to those. So the first one I'm going to do is the red wire. As I say, that red wire goes to the 5 volts, which is the middle blob. So using my tweezers, I'm just going to tack that on to the 5-volt rail, that middle one of the three we've made. Now the 0 volts, which is the second one up to this side, that needs to be the black of this end of the cable. So the supply side, if you like. So I'm going to take that black and put it on that side. And then finally, the blank from the device sides. And let's bring that one underneath there. And then we'll tack that onto the middle pin of the MOSFET. Okay, so we've got the two red wires coming in to the 5 volts. That's the bottom pin of the D1 mini. And it'll be the same for the V2 on the other side. Then on the device side, the black wire comes in and connects to the middle pin there of the MOSFET. So a quick visual check, just to make sure none of the tracks are shorted together. Okay, that looks good. So I can pull the wires through. And just make sure that all fits in the case. We'll take the lid, and there it is. So before we secure these cables in, we're gonna leave this floating. We're gonna plug it in and get it programmed. And then once we're done, I'll put some cable ties around those as strain relief, or maybe some hot glue. But there, let's get this programmed. Okay, so in ESPHome, we're going to make a new device, and I'm going to call this one Charger Phone. Main reason being is I've already made a charger tablet, so this one's going to be used on my phone. As always, I use Secret, so none of that makes any difference, nor does that. So, Charger Phone, let's open that up. We're going to take all the code from GitHub, and we're going to select all, paste that. Next thing I want to do is change the name. So this is phone. Ideally, you want this name here to match that. And then the only other thing I need to change in this code is I change the name. So I'm going to call this one phone, and I can use a capital letter here because the substitution that I'm using here is just for the names that show up in Home Assistant. Next thing I need to do is pick up the battery level from the app that's running on my phone. So for me, let's open up. Go to here, let's search for battery underscore level, and we'll scroll down, and here's Dave's phone. So I'm just going to click this icon here, which will copy it to the clipboard. I'll go back to here, select all that, and then Control V to paste it in. And then we will save this and get ready to flash. Okay, so for those of you who are interested, let's go through the code in a bit more depth. So first of all, we've got the device name. As I said, that's the same as the name you've called it in ESPHome. All my devices, I use secrets. So if you're not using secrets in your code, you'll need to add in your SSID and your Wi-Fi password there. Substitutions are split into two halves. Basically, you've got the variable, and this can be anything you want. I'm using device because that makes sense in this case, and the value of the variable. And the idea is that I can use this one word here and substitute it in all parts of my code. And we use the variable in our code with a dollar sign, open curly brackets, the name that we called the variable. So in my case, this is device. And then because this is a name, I can leave a space there because this is just an ordinary string. And then I put the word charger in. So in Home Assistant, this will get replaced with what the variable value is. So this will come in as phone space charger. That'll be the name of the switch, the actual switch that comes into Home Assistant. We'll take this string and change it to lowercase. So the switch itself will be switch, which is known as the domain. Then it'll be a dot. Then it'll be the name of the device. So in this case, phone. But because it's an entity name, that'll get changed to a lowercase. So that'll be lowercase phone. Then as we got a space there, obviously we can't have a space. That'll get changed to an underscore. The C will get changed to lowercase. So we have the word charger at the end. So the entity ID will be switch dot phone. Underscore lowercase charger. So the next part of this switch is obviously the pin that it's using. As you saw with the build, I'm using D2 and I've just given this an ID. I could have used phone ID, but it's internal, so it really doesn't make that much difference. And I've just called this one MOS because this pin is driving the MOSFET on the board. I've given it an icon. I'm using a USB port icon. You'll see that in Home Assistant in a minute. And then what I want this switch to do when it's turned on in either Home Assistant, or you'll see later on in the code, is on turn on, I want this switch to do two things. So when it's switched on, it's going to power up D2 as normal, but I also want it to turn on the LED. On the V3 board, the LED's on the top as we've made it. On the V2, unfortunately, the LED's on the bottom. So you may not see the LED. So continue on to the code. So on turn on, which means that when this switch gets turned on, then I want to do something. So in this case, I want the light dot turn underscore on. Then I need to tell it what light. So this is the ID for the light down here. So not only do I want to turn on the LED, I also want to apply an effect. So we'll do that with the word effect and then the effect name. And again, in the light platform, I've got an effect called pulse and I've called it pulse just to keep it easy. But this is a standard ESPHome effect for the light. So on turn off, which is this switch. So whenever this switch gets turned off, what I want to do there is light turn off and then the name of the LED again. And I don't need to indent this. I can just use light turn off. I could put that ID underneath there, but that would mean typing in ID LED, which I don't need. So I'm just turning off the LED. Now the sensor part of this is where all the magic happens. So I'm bringing in this entity ID from Home Assistant. And in order to do that, I need a sensor platform called Home Assistant. This is an API command that basically enables the D1 Mini to get data from Home Assistant. And the data I want, obviously, is the entity ID, and that's my phone battery. Next, we need to give it an ID so that I can reference this sensor elsewhere in the code. Also, you'll notice that I haven't given this a name. If I give it a name, then this sensor will go back into Home Assistant. I don't need that. It's already in Home Assistant. So if you eliminate the name but keep the ID, you'll always need an ID. It won't come back in. But just to make sure, I've made it internal and true. Next part of the code is filters. And basically, all this is doing is every 10 seconds, it's updating this sensor. So it's called heartbeat in filters. And basically every 10 seconds, it calls the API command and says, what's the value of that entity ID? So the level of my battery comes in as this, let's call it an entity. So what I want to do here is every 10 seconds on value. So that means I'm checking the value of this state, which is my battery, on value, if, and then I'm using the condition. So the condition is if the battery state is less than 70, and bear in mind that battery level is a percentage. So if the battery level is less than 70, then I want to switch, turn on the MOS. And remember the MOS is the ID of my switch, which is controlling the MOSFET. Else, if condition my battery is more than 80, then switch, turn off the MOSFET. So what this is going to do is every 10 seconds, this is going to check the level of my battery. If it's below 70, it's going to start charging it. It's going to keep on charging it until it gets above 80, and then it's going to stop charging. If it's not being charged, the battery will start dropping down. This code will allow the battery to drop down without being charged till it gets to 70 again. When it gets to 70, it's going to turn the MOSFET on, It's going to keep on going until that battery reaches 80, and it will keep the battery at maximum 80% and at minimum 70%. And then finally, I'm using the onboard LED on D4. So this part of the code is in two halves. I'm using the pulse width modulation, which gives me the ability to have effects and stuff. So I just called this one LED out for LED output. So the light part, I'm using the monochromatic light. Obviously, it's only one color. I've given it the ID here, which we've called here when we want to turn the light on. The output is LED out, which I've got down here. So that calls that. And then we've got the effects list. Now, the effect I'm using is pulse. I've given it a name of pulse so I can reference it. And what the pulse will do is it will turn the light on and off at specific intervals. So I've got this running as 1 second. And I'm also taking 1 second for it to ramp up and ramp down. So the transition length between off and on and off. So it'll take a second to turn on and off with a 1 second interval. So it'll just rise up and rise down. So you get a nice smooth on and off as opposed to a harsh on off. So none of this you'll need to change apart from adding in your own device's battery and at the top there, giving it a name and changing the name there for the switches. So with that done, we shall save that and we'll do an install. So I'm going to do a manual download. So that'll compile all the code for us. Okay, that's finished. It's made a bin file and is now asking me where I wanted to save it to. So I'm going to put that on my desktop and we'll just save that. Done. So we can close this down, get rid of that, and let's flash the device. I'm going to use the ESPHome flasher. I'm going to browse to the file we've just downloaded, which is chargerphone.bin. And then I'm going to plug in the USB to a D1 mini. You can see there the lights come on, computer's beeped. So I just need to refresh that, find the COM port that it's connected to, and press flash. That's finished flashing. Looks like it's connected to my Wi-Fi. Okay, so the next job is to bring this into Home Assistant. Normally you'd find a notification there for a new device. Mine hasn't showed up because I've already got this installed, so I'm going to have to put this in manually. But if yours doesn't show up, we'll just go to Integrations. We'll add a new integration. We want ESPHome. Then in here, I'm going to paste in the name of the device. So this is charger-phone. And instead of .yaml, we want .local. So we'll submit that. It's found it. We'll put it in. And then that shows up as charger-phone. And also the reason why I called it charger-phone and not phone charger. So these two are together. You'll also see, because the battery level of my phone is below one of the thresholds, the LED on my board is now doing its pulse because it knows that my phone is below that 70%. It's now in a charge state. So we'll go to my phone. We see we've got one device, which is the board itself, and one entity. And that entity is phone charger. So we look at that and we can see that the phone charger is on. So we can put this into Home Assistant. So if I click on that, I can pull in this. I'm just going to copy that. Then we'll go to one of my Lovelace panels. Let's do party time, which is my testing panel. And I'm just going to add in a button. And in the button, I'm just going to put that switch. So there it is down the bottom there. We'll just add that in. As you can see, it's brought the icon in and it's currently showing the state of the device. So if I turn the light off, you'll see the LED is on. You'll see the icon is on. And if I turn it off, the light goes off. And without doing anything, within 10 seconds or thereabouts, it'll read the level of my phone, realize that it's less than 70%, and you can see that both the icon and the LED has come on. I'm going to put all this back on my desk, and I'll show you a quick demo of it working. Okay, so we're all set up. There's the box that we made. It's all plugged into a wireless charger, and we're ready to go. So up here, I've got that switch as a button, and then over here, we're looking at the current state of my battery, which is now at 68%. So that means it's below that 70 threshold, which means the button's on. If I put my phone on the charger, you'll see that light up and it's now charging. So if I turn this off, you see it stops charging and then it will read the battery level again. Come on, the phone will realize and then it will start charging. So I can simulate different levels of my phone battery. So say for instance, I take it above that 80%, you'll see that that's gone off. This has gone off. If I take it off and put it back on again, it won't charge. And then within the 10 second heartbeat, it should read the battery again. So this will change down here to the 68, 69% that it was. So we can see now that's updated. It's now 66%. the chargers come on. And if we go back to the off screen, you should see now that it updates. And there we go. It's currently charging. So that's 66. So it'll keep on charging until it gets to 80%, and it will stop charging until it gets below 70%. And the cycle will continue, keeping that battery between 70 and 80% at all times.
Well, I hope this video was helpful with your projects. Please do share it so others can find it as well. I upload videos whenever I can, so subscribe and hit the bell icon to get notified. That's it. Thanks for watching.